The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Hamza Youssef for around 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to announce the Scottish Government has today published our autumn and winter vaccination strategy. I'm sure members will agree with me that the COVID-19 vaccination programme has been a resounding success. The NHS and indeed many, many others have mobilised at breakneck speed to match supply, thereby protecting the most vulnerable in our society at a scale that has never been experienced in living memory. It's easy to forget that it was only 9 months ago that we started receiving relatively small volumes of vaccine. We have now administered an incredible 8 million vaccine doses across Scotland, which demonstrates the incredible ability of our NHS and, again, our wider partners to respond in unprecedented circumstances. 92% of all people aged 18 and over have had a first dose of a COVID vaccine, and 86% have had a second dose. This is a remarkable achievement, and I want to put on record my sincere thanks to everyone involved in this, frankly, Herculean effort. Vaccinations continue to play a critical role in helping to protect the people of Scotland and support our wider global effort in reducing the harm caused by COVID-19. As part of our commitment to openness and to transparency, we have sought to keep Parliament and the public informed of our plans and our progress. Our autumn and winter vaccination strategy is part of this very commitment, and it illustrates we have exceeded our expectation set out in the original plans to vaccinate 80% of the eligible population. But more than that, this strategy outlines our vision and our commitment to continue to offer a vaccine to anyone eligible until at least spring next year. And finally, we set out how we will deliver COVID vaccinations alongside our biggest ever annual flu programme to help protect as many lives as possible this winter. I'm pleased that this morning Audit Scotland published their independent report on Scotland's COVID vaccination programme. It's an overwhelmingly positive report. Their report highlights the remarkable success of the programme and how we've ensured good collaboration and joint working right across the board while developing new digital tools at an extraordinary pace. I hope members will get a chance to look through this very insightful report. The Audit Scotland report also highlights that the programme has been, and I'm quoting, effective in reducing the number of people getting severely ill and dying from COVID-19, delivered in a variety of ways to make it easier for more people to access them, and the level of vaccine wastage has been low, end quote. I know there is often much political and media commentary, understandably so, of course, when Audit Scotland produced challenging reports. I hope there will also be attention paid to reports like this one, stating where excellent progress has been made in relation to the vaccination programme. As we look ahead to the autumn and winter months, it is vital we build on our achievements and continue to deliver COVID vaccinations, as well as seasonal flu vaccinations to all those who are eligible in Scotland. A key feature of the COVID-19 vaccination programme has been the evolving clinical advice, which has required the programme to pivot, often at quite short notice, to include new groups of people or change the vaccines we have used. This has included, for example, extending our offer to 12 to 15-year-olds, following advice from the JCVI and then the four UK chief medical officers. I'd like to thank our vaccinators for the care and sensitivity with which they are helping particularly younger people and their parents and carers to engage with the vaccination programme. It is important to reinforce that choice remains central to our approach. A great deal of emphasis is being placed on access to quality information, supported by discussions at vaccination centres to address any questions or concerns young people may have. That was one of the key considerations which informed our own delivery and why we deliberately started vaccinations for young people within community settings to enable them to be accompanied by a parent or carer and have those really important discussions. Presiding Officer, we are also now administering a third primary dose of COVID vaccinations to those who are severely immunosuppressed, and we've begun a programme of booster doses for those most at risk from severe disease. Booster doses are given at least 6 months after the second dose. And this year, more than ever, we must ensure those in the higher risk age groups are protected against other seasonal respiratory illnesses, such as flu. our immunity may be even lower than usual due to lower levels of flu circulating last year as a result of the crucial public health measures that were in place at that time to protect the population from COVID. Therefore, earlier this month, we launched Scotland's biggest ever flu vaccination programme with expanded eligibility criteria to include everyone over 50, health and social care workers, including independent contractors such as GPs, dental and optometry staff, teachers, nursery teachers and support staff, and prison population. I would urge us all to come together to thank all of those who have been involved in the vaccination programme and to those who will support it as we move forward. From those who work tirelessly in our NHS, across local government, to those in the Army that have helped out and continue to help out, to the many volunteers also who have stepped forward at this crucial time. I'm also grateful to the many faith, third sector and community groups who have contributed so much to supporting our efforts to deliver an inclusive national programme. We could not have achieved this remarkable success without your help. So today I want to express my thanks to everyone who has stepped forward to be vaccinated and the vaccinators. The overwhelming response from the people of Scotland has been inspiring. The vaccines are highly effective at preventing severe disease, and getting fully vaccinated remains the best way to be protected against the virus. I urge anyone who is eligible and not yet received a COVID vaccination to book an appointment or indeed attend a drop-in clinic at the earliest opportunity. For anyone who is hesitant because they need more reassurance or indeed information, our vaccination teams will be happy to discuss the benefits with you. We have continuously adapted our vaccination programme and incorporated lessons learned into our planning and delivery, regularly seeking feedback both from those directly and those that are indirectly involved in the programme. Vaccination along with testing remains our best route out of the pandemic, and it's crucial people do come forward. As a result of the positive impact of the vaccination programme, the rate of increase in COVID-19 cases has been less amongst those who are fully vaccinated compared with partially or indeed unvaccinated people, demonstrating the protection that's offered by vaccination. I think many members know this statistic, but it is always worth repeating that at the start of the year, around 12% of cases were ending up in hospital. But that figure is now down to around about 2%. Across all age groups, the rate of hospital admission has been higher in unvaccinated people compared to vaccinated individuals. Most younger adults will have received their second COVID vaccine dose in late summer or early autumn, but there are currently over 170,000 adults under 40 who have had their first dose but have yet to come forward for their second. Getting your second dose, if eligible, will give you longer lasting protection from the virus, and all help play a part in keeping your friends, your family, your community and, of course, yourself safe. So my plea to those who have not attended their appointment for a second dose, don't leave the job half done. Please attend a drop-in clinic or arrange an appointment for the second dose of your vaccine. We've undertaken a range of national activity as well as a range of targeted communications and engagement to encourage people who haven't had their second dose for any reason to complete their vaccination. That includes a personal letter from our Chief Medical Officer. We continue to work with colleges and universities to maximise vaccine uptake among students who are not fully vaccinated. Clear communications are a key part to encouraging uptake. And we're working across social media channels to inform students of the benefits of getting vaccinated. Academic institutions are also being encouraged to work with student representatives to encourage uptake. Following advice, Presiding Officer, from the JCVI and the four UK Chief Medical Officers, all children aged 12 to 15 are now being offered a dose of the COVID vaccine. Health boards have begun to offer vaccinations to as many children as possible. Drop-in clinics open for 12 to 15-year-olds to attend with their parents or carers last week. This week, eligible children and young people will be offered an appointment either at school or a community clinic. Most young people in this age group will receive a blue envelope with a scheduled appointment time and the national information leaflet. This will be for a community clinic in their health board area. There are some regions not undertaking the blue envelope or community clinic model. These are NHS Borders, Dumfries and Galloway, some parts of NHS Ireland and some island boards. In these cases, a school delivery model began earlier this week with the leaflet letter and consent form going home in school bags and those aforementioned health board. I would encourage parents, carers and young people to read the material provided and reach an informed decision. I'm pleased to report the rollout also has begun of our seasonal flu programme and is progressing well. We launched our childhood and school vaccination programme on the 6th of September. Primary and secondary school pupils started receiving their flu vaccine from that date. And from the 20th of September, NHS boards began to vaccinate residents in care homes. The Health and Social Care Workers online portal for booking appointments also went live on the 21st of September. As members will be aware, we've prioritised those at the highest clinical risk and indeed pregnant women. I'll just end, because I'm already over time, Presiding Officer, by saying we are working closely with NHS Scotland partners, local authorities and healthcare partnerships to proactively manage current system pressures. And there are system pressures in terms of the workforce. We've been clear that the conditions are likely to remain challenging. So I will make a statement, hopefully to Parliament next week, just setting out immediate actions the Scottish Government can do to assist to mitigate some of those pressures on our health service. Based on the success and good practice of the COVID programme, we'll continue to improve, build and adapt the vital resources to deliver future vaccination programmes. Let me thank all of those who have been involved in making our vaccination programme an incredible success, and I look forward to taking questions from members.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, at which point we'll need to move on to next business. And I would encourage all members who wish to ask a question to press their request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Dr. Sandis Gouldhany.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of the statement. I want to say to anyone watching at home, who is eligible for the COVID vaccination or the flu vaccination, to please get it, because it will save lives. I've had both of my COVID vaccinations and I will be getting my flu vaccination. Tess White has a disabled constituent who will have to travel from Inverbervie to Stonehaven to get his vaccination, which will take him an hour door to door. Will the Cabinet Secretary set out a maximum travel time for patients, especially in rural areas? And will the Cabinet Secretary explain why he is going to give us a further update in a week, and not now, on vital information about mitigating pressures, maximising capacity and supporting our system response, which is key to delivery?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Dr. Kahani for his question, and can I thank him for the plea that he makes at the beginning, coming from not just an opposition politician, but obviously somebody who is a practicing GP. I think that is a really important call to make to people. In terms of the details of Tess White's constituent, I'd be happy if Ms. White would like to forward me details of that disabled constituent. I think health boards are working extremely hard to ensure that there are drop-in clinics available as close to people as possible. If that is not happening, I'm more than happy to take it up with the relevant health board. So there are drop-in centres right across the country. I wouldn't expect somebody to have to travel an hour. That seems to me an excessively long journey for somebody to take. So if Ms. White would like to forward me the details, I will do that. And my statement, hopefully, to Parliament will be in less than a week. And of course, we have already taken action to try to mitigate some of the winter pressures we're facing. This will be a further update to that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Jackie Bailey.
And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for an advance copy of his statement. The demands on the NHS are currently at crisis point, so delivering the flu vaccination and COVID booster programme at pace will be critically important. So can the Cabinet Secretary commit to doing the flu programme at least before Christmas rather than by March to better protect the NHS? I also welcome the development of the long-term sustainable vaccination workforce, but this of course will take time. In the meantime, locum pharmacists do not appear to be used to the same extent as locum GPs or indeed nurses. So can the Cabinet Secretary commit to using locum pharmacists as well as commercial pharmacies to deliver the programme? And finally, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that uptake is lower in disadvantaged areas. Can he therefore ensure that the vaccination centres that were closed are now reopened in order that vaccinations are delivered as locally as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can thank Jackie Bailey for a number of questions. In terms of the programme ongoing with the booster campaign, third dose campaign, continuing COVID evergreen campaign, as we might call it, plus the flu vaccination, we are talking about 7.5 million vaccines over the course of autumn and winter. So in the space of a few months, we're going to try to deliver 7.5 million doses, which is just less than the 8 million doses that we've delivered in the last 9 months. So an incredible effort is needed. We are confident of meeting the timescales that we have set out in the strategy. Of course, if Ms Bailey, as she requests, if we can go any quicker than that, I promise her we absolutely will. But as she has referenced already in her second part of her question, the NHS is facing severe pressures. And therefore, we've got to be able to make sure we're doing this in a way that is, of course, with pace, but also managing some of those really challenging pressures. Of course, I will look at the issue again of locum pharmacists. It's an issue my sister, who is a locum pharmacist herself, has raised with me, I think, in my first week as Health Secretary. But it's also a conversation I had with the Chief, Pharmaceutical Officer, Alison Strath. So I will take that issue away, because anything we can do to maximise our workforce is a good idea. On the final point that Ms Bailey raises, yes, again, I will. I have, as you can imagine, very regular engagement with health boards. If there is more they can do around opening up additional vaccine centres, then I'm sure that is an issue that I will raise with them, but I'm sure it's an issue they're proactively looking at. But it isn't just about access, because I do think, and I think Ms Bailey would agree with me generally, when it came to dose one and dose two of the vaccine, I think it would be fair to say there was very good coverage of local drop-in centres, generally across the country. We've got to do more around communication, doing what we can to work with the third sector, working with faith leaders, for example, working with our ethnic minority organisations like Bemis, who have been excellent, to try to outreach to those groups where uptake is lower. And any suggestions that anybody has in this chamber will be met with an open mind from me.
Thank you. Gillian Martin, to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm going to ask the Cabinet Secretary to address the issue of rural people, not just for the COVID vaccine, but more for the flu vaccination rollout. What advice he gives to health boards that there's issues about people in rural areas accessing the centres, the urban centres where the vaccination programme has been rolled out?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, no, I think that's a really fair point, actually, made by Gillian Martin. And, you know, people obviously can find the clinics that are local to them following the NHS board's webpage. We also have a landing page on NHS Inform that takes you to your health board area, which allows you to see the nearest drop-in clinic to you. I know this is a particular issue in rural areas, and what can seem like a relatively short distance, actually, due to public transport links and so on and so forth, again, particularly at weekends, can be a much longer journey. So I'm more than happy to speak to the rural boards in particular about that issue. If there are cases, and I make this as a very open offer, if there are cases, as Dr. Ghani has already done on behalf of Tess White, if there are cases where the journey time seems unreasonable, then I'm more than happy for MSPs to write to me directly, and I'll be happy to raise those with the health board.
Sue Webber, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and let me also put on record my thanks to all of those in our health service who participated in delivering the vaccine programme. It has clearly saved lives and will continue to do so. Cabinet Secretary, today's Audit Scotland report states that the vaccine programme so far has been reliant on temporary staff and volunteers. It notes that work is currently taking place to establish the size of workforce that's needed, and I notice that there's reference to this within the development plan. The Cabinet Secretary...
Question, please, Ms Webber.
Rightio. You've recognised these pressures, comma. How many staff do you envisage will be required to sustain not only the COVID vaccine programme, but the flu one as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Ms Webber for the question, because it is an incredibly important one. So she will know that the information on page 19 of the strategy deals with workforce. It gives detail of how many vaccinators we have to date, and how many vaccinators, how many volunteer hours have also helped in that vaccination effort. I won't put a number on it just now, because it obviously would depend on the diversity of that workforce. But what I would say to Ms Webber is that no stone from this government is being left unturned to make sure that we meet the very ambitious targets, as I've already referenced to Ms Bailey, of our vaccination programme for the autumn winter.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update as to how Scots who have been vaccinated outside of Scotland, including my constituent who lives in Ecclefechan but works for NHS England, where they were first vaccinated, how can they obtain proof of vaccination status?
Cabinet Secretary.
So there's a number of things that can be done. First and foremost, can I say to anybody who's been vaccinated, for example, outside of Scotland, you know, when it comes to the certification scheme that comes into force 5 a.m. tomorrow, you can use, for example, the NHS England app, or indeed you can use certification proof from anywhere across the common travel area. And for a number of these countries within the common travel area, we already have, for example, with England, a data exchange that is available. What we're doing from tomorrow is launching an online form for people to complete if they've been vaccinated in England, Wales or Northern Ireland but live in Scotland. We ask that if an individual's vaccination from another part of the UK is not showing, and there may well be times when there are errors, I know members have contacted me about that, we would ask people to phone the COVID status helpline on 0808 196 8565 and they aim to fix these issues within 14 days.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill, to be followed by John Mason.
I am at a loss to understand why the GCVI don't consider police officers amongst being a priority group, but given the incredible efforts that Police Scotland and serving police officers will make, policing COP26 with up to 25,000 people attending, exposing them to considerable risks, I ask the Cabinet Secretary, is the government planning on asking the GCVI to include police officers as being a priority for the booster vaccine, as they should be?
Cabinet Secretary.
So can I say to Pauline McNeill that I know she asked the question with absolute sincerity, and I, as a former Justice Secretary, know the incredible efforts that our police officers, men and women right across the country, make, and she's right to reference the fact that they will do make an incredible impact in relation to our arrangements around COP26. What I would say to Pauline McNeill is that it's right that the GCVI give us that clinical expertise. It is also the case, in my understanding, that police officers have taken up, of course, in good numbers, in very high numbers, the offer of a vaccination. So we'll continue to listen to the advice of the GCVI in terms of when and who should be prioritised in relation to vaccination and immunisation.
John Mason, to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you very much. I wonder what advice the Cabinet Secretary would give to somebody who is thinking of declining their third or booster jag because they would like to see that jag going to somebody in the developing world.
Cabinet Secretary.
I would ask them not to delay. I can understand what may seem like good intentions on their behalf, but to give them some sort of assurance, we're working with international partners and also working with the UK Government, Welsh Government and Northern Irish Government in relation to the COVAX scheme. And I've had many good conversation, I should say, with other health ministers right across the UK about what contribution Scotland can make to that global effort. But by not going for your booster dose or your third dose or indeed any of the first two doses, that doesn't automatically guarantee that that dose ends up somewhere in the developing world. So please be assured that we are working with international partners and domestic partners around the COVAX scheme, working with the World Health Organization. But please, if you are eligible for a vaccine, first, second, third, or indeed booster dose, then please step forward.
Craig Hoy, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. On the issue of the SNP's shambolic plans for COVID certification, very little has been said so far about how fraud will be combated. So, in the absence of a photographic component, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me how the system actually proves that the person who presents the passport is, in fact, the same person to whom it was issued? Because as far as I can see, it doesn't, and from tomorrow, the system will be wide open to fraud through impersonation.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't agree, of course, with Craig Hoy's characterisation of the scheme. And in fact, of course, the courts have made it clear in their judgment that they believe that we have taken the appropriate steps in relation to launching our scheme tomorrow. So I don't agree with his characterisation of it being shambolic. What I would say, secondly, is a number of security features on the COVID certificate. The QR code itself, of course, cannot be altered. What I would say is I find it slightly distressing that Craig Hoy is now suggesting that people should have to prove their ID and show their ID alongside any paper copy of the vaccination status. That is not something that we are calling for. And I would say to Mr Hoy, although I respect the fact that he disagrees, he shouldn't be trying to create confusion or indeed giving inaccurate claims around a certification scheme.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, we know that winter pressures on the NHS exist at all times, notwithstanding COVID in the mix for this year coming. But can you please emphasise to people how important it is that the flu jab is taken up in order to protect our NHS over the winter period?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, in short, I mean, it's absolutely vital, and the information and advice I've received from our own clinicians is where we can, we will try to co-administer both the booster and the flu vaccine. But, of course, in some cases, the timeline won't necessarily match up, and therefore what we're not going to do is delay the flu vaccine. It's really, really important, given that we fear the worst around the flu vaccine because we think people's immunity is lower to flu because there wasn't much flu circulating last year. It's really, really vital to protect our NHS, but of course to protect individuals and people themselves, that they come forward and take up that offer of the flu vaccine as soon as their priority group is eligible.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Several pharmaceutical companies are in advanced clinical trials on second-generation vaccines that particularly target vaccine escape in variations like Delta. Can the Cabinet Secretary firstly reassure the Chamber that current first-generation vaccines are highly effective at preventing serious illness, but could he also indicate to the Chamber how we will fold in those second-generation vaccines into the booster programme when they become available?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for a very good question. Yes, on this first point, of course, they are highly effective, and there's plenty of data there and research to show the efficacy of the current vaccines. Again, this is a conversation that I have regularly across the four nations with other health ministers. What we do, of course, is wait for not just the MHRA approval once the clinical trials have been completed. And I think we're expecting the results of the COV-Boost trial mid next month. Once we receive those results, of course, it will be for the JCVI and others to give details of how those vaccines should be deployed. But we are well plugged into that and hope to get the results of the COV-Boost trial, I think, in mid next month. But I will come back to the member with further detail.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, those who are vulnerable to flu, such as those with mild to moderate asthma and young children, were not in the original priority groups for the COVID vaccine. I'm concerned that as the flu and COVID booster vaccine programmes are run simultaneously, there's a risk that some may incorrectly assume that they are not eligible or do not need a flu vaccine. How will the Scottish Government ensure that those who are eligible for the flu vaccine are aware of this and attend to their appointment?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's an excellent question by Gillian Mackay, because it is, there can be some confusion. There are a number of vaccines underway. We talked about a third dose, we talk about a booster dose, we talk about a flu vaccine, and so on and so forth. And she's absolutely right. So I'm working, and already we have done work on this actually, with communication colleagues to see how can we simplify the message, target it to those that we think are eligible, and make sure that nobody is missed out. But we are urgently working on that. We've done some work on that already, and she will have seen some of the communications, but I think it can be made a bit sharper and a bit crisper, and therefore we're actively exploring that very issue as we speak.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary, when is the anticipated completion date for all COVID booster vaccines to have been administered?
Cabinet Secretary.
In some respects, it's an evergreen offer, because she will be aware from my statement and from previous statements on the booster programme, of course, the booster dose can't be given until 6 months after the second dose. So we will continue to offer that. So it's, I suppose, not possible in some respects to have a definitive completion date, but we aim to provide boosters to those who are eligible as close to the 6 months from receiving the second dose. But we'll keep that programme rolling on and rolling on, much like we're doing for the primary doses of the vaccine.
Thank you. Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Mercedes de Alba.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The pandemic has clearly shown the inequalities that our communities still face. One of them is, of course, internet access. The Scottish Government vaccination strategy is clear in its push for online bookings, but the Cabinet Secretary knows that many of our constituents still are unable to gain access either at home or at their local libraries. This is a real issue, particularly for older residents. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary how the Scottish Government intend to reach out to those with no internet access? Will the Government commit more resources for hard copy letters to be sent?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Mr. Chowdhury for the question? Can I also, before I answer this question, pay credit to him personally, because I know he's been involved, particularly in the ethnic minority community in Edinburgh, through the work he's done with ELRIC over a number of years to make sure that the vaccine uptake is high amongst those ethnic minority communities. So can I thank Mr. Chowdhury for his personal efforts in that regard. Let me give him an absolute assurance for those that do not register with the portal, there will be a deduplication process and then letters will be sent out. We absolutely have the resource for that, but based on his question, I will go away to look to see if there's anything further we can do for those that may well be digitally excluded.
And briefly, Mercedes Villalba.
Vaccination and testing are both crucial tools in ensuring that our schools remain safe for staff and pupils. Teachers are eligible for the flu jab this year but are not being prioritised for the COVID booster jab. Will the Cabinet Secretary look again at this decision and also commit to not introducing charges for lateral flow tests?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would have real concerns about changing away from, or moving away, I should say, from our universal offer of lateral flow tests. So that is absolutely not within this government's purview at the moment at all. I know it has been raised by the UK government as part of their winter plan, but I've put on record to the UK government that I think it's a wholly inappropriate step to be taking. And in fairness to the UK government, I don't think they're looking to do that immediately. On her first question, again, much like I said to her colleague Polly McNeill, we take advice from the experts on vaccine and immunisation, the JCVI. If they change their advice, of course, we will listen to that. What I would say, first of all, put my on record my thanks to our teachers for the incredible work they've done throughout the pandemic to make sure that our children's education is not disrupted. What I would say to those teachers is please do step forward for your booster vaccine when you are eligible 6 months after the second dose that you've received.
Thank you very much. That concludes questions on the statement, and there will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.